Metro. Metro Radio.
Well, in the showbiz news, fans have travelled from around the world to potentially see Susan Boyle make a rare public appearance in Newcastle tonight. It's the world premiere of the musical all about her life called I Dreamed a Dream. Elaine C Smith is taking on the title.
This is your Act One Beginner School. Thank you.
Beautiful. Thank you. Have a good show.
Okay. This is what fear looks like. And no matter how many shows you've done, it never feels any better. I just... terror. We're going to the Grand Central Hotel. Hello. I'm going to get slap on, so hopefully I look a bit better than this. This is just day wear slap. So we're going to get the polyfiller on now. And then we're going to do... who are the photographs we're doing now?
We're doing photographs for ourselves.
For ourselves. Of Susan and
Anne. Susan and you. And then we're doing the Mail on Sunday of Susan and you.
Right.
One way or another, I'm going to find you. I'm going to get you. One way or another, I'm going to win you. I'm going to get you.
A musical about the life of Susan Boyle.
Joined now by the star of that musical, Elaine C. Smith, and of course the woman herself, Susan Boyle, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, Susan and I have been rushing about doing all this publicity because, of course, the plan is that Susan, if she can, is going to come on at the end and maybe sing a couple of songs. And we've got 13 very big theatres already booked across the UK. And we haven't even started rehearsals yet. Look, right, I'm off. I better get to my work. I'm a weighty act. I know what you're thinking. I know you're thinking, wouldn't it be great if at this point in our story, our fairy story, that I was found sitting on my own, eating biscuits, feeling sorry for myself, when suddenly an advert for a talent show came on to the television?
Yeah, great.
That is exactly what happened.
But not that exactly what happened. No one would believe that.
No one. I mean,
I think that's funny.
Yeah.
Because you say to us, I mean, no one would believe that,
that's,
would they?
Yes, I can't. No one would believe that, would they?
Boom.
Well, next up is a contestant who thinks she has what it takes to put Glasgow on the map.
Hello there.
Hello, how are you doing?
I'm good, how are you?
My name is Susan Boyle.
I was actually on stage with Calendar Girls, but we were waiting to go on in the interval. It was in the West End, and Linda Bellingham and Patricia Hodge ran out of the dressing room. Oh, the lady, you should see this wee woman. I was crying from Glasgow. And she said, oh, she looked terrible, but then when she went on, so it was brilliant.
And that's just one side of me.
I turned around and went, oh, don't, Alan.
Are you still talking?
Yes. Sorry, your tea's just coming.
You've got acting to do.
No, I can't.
You don't just get to do one scene and then go home. You're in all of it.
I didn't do it very well. I haven't even gone for a pee. But what, the end of it is that I turned and I went, I said, oh, don't, I'll end up playing on the story of her life. And joked.
What's the dream?
I'm trying to be a professional singer. I'm going to sing I Dreamed a Dream from The Miserables.
Okay.
I know it's not an easy song to sing. It's really not an easy song to sing at all. None of them are from Les Mis. They're all very, very technical, difficult songs to sing. She absolutely nailed it, you know? And done with that Scottishness, you know, that kind of, hey, I've just delivered it. There you go, nailed it to the post. And I just loved that about her. I was just like, well, there you go.
I dreamed a dream in time gone by.
For me, it was a tipping point of our obsession with celebrity and Botox and blonde and the pages of certain magazines about those who could live the perfect life and are judging a book by its cover. And anybody who says they didn't do that when Susan walked on the stage is a liar.
Life has killed the dream.
Cinderella does go to the ball. That, you know, sitting in a house, staring at four walls and suddenly bang, you're out of working class Blackburn and you're a major international star.
Welcome back to the 5:30 show. Now, on Friday, she was known to only her friends and family. That all changed the next evening after she appeared in Britain's Got Talent. 12 million viewers were mesmerised by the amazing voice of Susan Boyle from Blackburn.
What made you go in for this? Because you're a shy person. What made you push yourself forward for this?
Well, basically, I wanted to fulfil a wish to my mother that I wanted to do something with my life. And not only that, I felt I had a bit more to offer.
Susan had said in an interview when somebody said, who do you want to play you in the movie? And lots of Hollywood names were being talked about, Michelle Pfeiffer and Glenn Close. And Susan said, oh, there's a wonderful Scottish actress called Elaine C Smith. I'd love her to play me.
But I ended up on a beach in just on Loch Lomond, being interviewed on Real Radio or something. And I said, no, it won't be me. It'll be Michelle Pfeiffer in a fat suit with a bad Irish accent. I said, that's what happens.
Elaine and I were laughing about it on the phone one day. And I said, well, you know, maybe you won't get the movie, but there's a good idea for a musical there. And we sort of finished the conversation, hung up, and then almost rang each other back at the same time going, just say that again. And that's really how the idea came about. So it was all to do with Susan. It was all Susan saying, this is the person that I want to play me.
When I first read Susan's book, it was amazing. I couldn't believe that motherly connection.
Stan, come on, Stan. Come on.
Where Susan was brought up was about 25 miles from here. When I was 3, 4, this was, the Duchess Park was the posh park. The Duchess of Hamilton Park. And I was sort of born, the first house my mum and dad had was just up there on Watson Street. A tenement, single end, as they called them. I couldn't believe the parallels. We sung in the same clubs. I started singing up the road in a club with Motherwell Trades and Labour. 50 pence I got for a Saturday with my cousin John, Jim, and in a not very good band, but we thought we were brilliant.
Hey, what are you doing in a pub on your own? You come and give us a wee song, have you?
Well, I've never sung in front of people before.
At the same time, Susan and I are only a couple of years apart, so at the same time, she was not singing with bands, but that was what she wanted to do.
Someone to watch over you.
Len? Well, I'll watch over you.
Hey! Hey! You must have a chance there.
Yeah.
Music had a soothing, calming, happy influence on her, in what might have been in other areas an unhappy time in her life, where she was struggling at school or struggling to connect with friends, or she had difficulty with all of that. That music was the thing that made it better.
If there was a family celebration, then we all gathered at our house. The good rug was rolled up, the three-piece suite pushed against the walls, the good ornaments locked away in the sideboards, and a coffee table covered in crisps and nuts and platefuls of salmon sandwiches, if we were lucky.
I also loved sitting around the living room and hearing, Kate sing Vincent or Kate or somebody else sing a Frank Sinatra song. And I realised now in my own life, you know, and when I was 18 and with bands and in my, you know, Afghan coat and patchouli, I would come in and go, oh, for God's sake, they're singing. Here they go. Two cigarettes in an ashtray. You know, it's, my love and I, take the ribbon from my hair. Don't look so sad. All those songs that used to make my Archibald clench, you know. You'd go, oh, no. And now it's amazing because I see my daughters be embarrassed by exactly the same thing when she walks out of the house and me and Andy Gray on the mic, and I've got a karaoke and everybody's up, and they walk out and go, oh no, they're singing. But I also know they'll remember it. There's something for me, it sounds, I suppose maybe I'm just half daft, but when I do that, when we're in our living room and everybody's sitting round and there's a party and drinking and laughing and or not drinking and just the kids are there and everybody's up singing, all my ancestors are in the room.
All my family could sing. My Uncle Tommy, my mum, Bridie, Mary, Kathleen, Jerry, but my dad, oh, my dad. When he sung, he could stop the room.
All right, this is for Susan on a special day. I peeked in to say good night, and there I heard my child in prayer.
And what is wonderful in the creation of the show was seeing that and writing that room. And it wasn't really Susan's room, that living room. It was my living room. But for huge swathes of the population in Scotland, that is it. That gathering of people singing, love it or hate it, embarrassed by it or not, it's a absolute part of the DNA. And that was... I don't mean I sat down to write that, but it's emerged.
Yeah, rendered the entire conversation pointless.
Were you thinking in terms of me going from the pub?
I don't want to be the person that went out and made a lot of money doing Sing Along of Susan in the pavilion, packing them in. For me to live with and look at myself in the mirror, I had to do something that had a bit of substance and depth and meant something to our family. You know, I had our family, our sisters were all over the house, and sisters and nieces and all of that. And that meant a lot, you know, that they were assured that we weren't out to do any exploitative thing on. Or that we were going to do some sugary sweet thing either.
Yes, Susan.
Did anybody invite you?
I was leaving her house and it was lovely. She put her arms around me and said to me, I'd be honoured if you played me, Elaine. And it was a hard sort of choice. And we had a laugh. And she said, I said, are you having a big do? And she says, yeah. And she said, do you want to come? And I went, of course I would. But I said, you'll have all your family. And she said, no. So I got a lovely invite, which was really nice.
And so what's happening tonight? Apparently there's going to be a big party for family and friends and for your loved ones.
There'll be a party and friends. It's at a location somewhere.
Keeping that quiet. Mum is the word for that one.
Uh-huh.
And then when I went to her 50th, I remember looking at all our family and then I did see what the journey was.
Right, you can hold the mic because you're used to that. There you are.
Everything is beautiful. Don't sing that to anybody.
She looked beautiful and she had, you know, gorgeous outfit and really happy and I thought, oh, it's a fairy story.
Happy birthday to you. There you go. I hope you made a wish.
I did.
I think it came true in the last 2 years, though.
I think it did.
Happy birthday.
What more could you wish for?
And after her birthday, I came home and sat down at 4:30 in the morning, couldn't sleep, and wrote the opening monologue. And I sent it to the producer and I said, whoever we get to write this, we've got to have something like this in it. It's about her magic and where she comes from. And if we don't understand that, we don't understand the magnitude of what's happened. And I finally found out there was something I could do. I could sing, and it was magic.
I thought it.
I'm really glad that she's been incredibly open about her learning difficulties and her being bullied because of them.
No! They don't need to see this! No! They don't need to see this!
A lot of the time she would provoke the bullies by shouting and bawling at them, and then they would tease her because they knew she would blow up. From a hood or whatever, One, two. I knew on the times that I met Susan that there was a fragility there and that she didn't have that robust sense of performing, you know, and that the nerves
that she experienced are pretty crippling. Susan has only ever done sort of one-off couple of songs. She's never done a concert tour, you know. And going from singing two songs in a karaoke to where she is, she hasn't had the bit in between that we've all had, where you learn how to do it and how to speak to an audience and all that. The first sort of wah-wah pedal.
The first Donny
Osmond. The first Donny. But really... So they thought this would be a great opportunity, actually, for Susan to be with a theatre company, know it and feel secure, and also be able to go out and then come on at the end and do a couple of songs. Because this was untried for Susan, about turning up every night and doing this, I thought it was a huge risk.
If for whatever reason, illness or that, Susan was not to make it, hopefully by that time we'll have done our job well enough that, you know, the audience won't mind and Susan will be a bonus. It's a theatrical piece, it's a play with music that kind of comments on the action and drives the action, and as all songs and musicals should do, they vocalise what the character singing it can't put into words.
It was a huge hit in the 70s by Glasgow-born singer-songwriter Jamie Rafferty.
Oh, I know
who wrote Baker Street, and this is his other big hit.
I know Baker Street.
Stuck in the middle with you.
Go on.
Clowns to the left of me, jokers to the right, here I am, stuck in the middle with you. Well, I started up with nothing, and if I'm in, I'm a selfie man.
We don't try to claim that anything within it has a literal truth, but that it captures an essence or a sense of a moment in her life or a moment in time. Her character, for example, Elaine, who's playing Susan, starts right from the off by telling us that this is the way in which she is going to communicate with us, is through essentially what is Susan's inner voice.
This is what I sound like in here. This is the Susan you don't get to see. Because what you see is the woman who's a bit shy, a bit awkward, doesn't know what to say, and most of the time I don't really know what to say. But when I'm with my family, I gab away 10 to the dozen and tell the world and his wife exactly what it should be up to. But when somebody puts a microphone in front of me, I clam up and I see something like bloody fantastic.
Nervous. I always get nervous. And if I wasn't nervous, I'd be very worried. And you've got to use the nerves to concentrate the mind. My research really is listening to Elaine. Elaine and I talk a lot. I mean, she'll send me texts when she says, I was speechless. I'm like, what? I didn't believe that for a second. But she, no, you don't try. Get a word in. Just wait until, wait, little pause.
For me, what was interesting as well was her looking back and trying to understand herself, where she'd come from and what had happened to her. And I know in my own journey in show business, that's the most difficult thing. Why were you chosen? Why have you been given all these opportunities and gifts and or chances?
She couldn't grasp, but she still can't, why people were suddenly interested in a 47-year-old spinster with false teeth and dodgy hair.
This will be one of the few times you hear me say it. I literally don't care where you end up, but keep moving.
Susan had no real idea of the effect she'd had. Well, she couldn't grasp, well, she still can't, why suddenly everyone was so interested in a 47-year-old spinster with false teeth and dodgy. I mean, when she saw the BBC van outside her house, she panicked. Well, she thought they were coming to arrest her for not paying her licence.
You say Susan, Susan?
Susan!
Susan, get the weed!
You're making all the attention, eh? Eh, what? I've no script.
Have you really never been kissed?
Never been, no comment.
What does it mean to get the support of Jimmy Moore?
It's overwhelming. I mean, that's something else.
You know who Jimmy Moore is?
Of course I do. Ghost, she's in there.
What is it, Doug Smile? You get the thumbs up. The way in which you ask the questions, I think, has to sort of take on a pretense of we're your best mate. Because if you're my best mate, then you won't be everybody else's best mate, which means that That's where the exclusive lies.
The press genuinely do like new people coming along. Mm, yeah. And also, from our point of view, she loved, for the first time, people asking her questions. Nobody was interested in Susan at all. So
any attitude, even.
I could see the way the papers, when I did get a hold of it, they sort of made me go, oh. I could see the way that they were dealing with it was they just wanted the angle and the story.
How's Pebbles taking it?
Pebbles? Pebbles, she's a bloody cat. No, but if you don't mind, thanks all for coming, but I really need
Susan, a wee gift for Pebbles.
Oh, well, that's lovely, thanks.
Gavin Jackson.
Okay, just hold it there.
Susan Press.
I do remember thinking, I hope this woman's looked after properly, because this game could eat her up. And when I did see it, that was a concern that I had, and I also knew that in many ways for that family and that community, what had occurred to her was like a bomb going off. And that everybody wanted to think that what would come out of the bomb would be fairy dust, but actually a bit of shrapnel comes out of it too. And any cracks in the family, any disagreements, anything like that.
We had a meeting with the family, two of Susan's sisters and two of her nieces, and they quite rightly were concerned about how their parents and sister and mum were going to be portrayed in the show, you know, doing high kicks and jazz hands in the middle of the stage.
We are portraying a family on stage. People are playing Susan's father, Susan's mother, and other members of her family, and I think there's a certain degree of responsibility and duty to that you honour the memory of what's a family means to each other, and particularly when Susan has to come and watch it and sees her mother and father interacting with her and somebody playing her on stage.
I was really proud of her that night. I hope she knows that, because as a father you don't always get it right, and sometimes you're not given the time to say the things you need to.
It's a show that looks at memory and dreams and the way in which we self-edit our own lives and how that relates to Susan and how that relates to all of us, really. You do sit there wondering whether it hangs together and whether that moment will work, and it is this weird mix of sort of the creative side of you as a storyteller wondering about what you've done to the story that you've worked so hard to sort of piece together in a rehearsal room. You're wondering whether that moment will work in the way which you've asked it to.
You never know until you're in front of the audience. You never know. Will it entertain them as well? Are those moments going to actually, will we be able to lift it?
Just like every child.
Just like every child.
Too much?
What really, really hard for 4 weeks, and in every job I've done, you know, if I'm near home, then it's become a bit of a tradition to carry karaoke and back in the house. And what I'm recreating is the sing song that you have in this. The sing songs I was brought up in.
All I do is ride around Sally.
Ride, Sally, ride.
All you wanna do is ride around Sally.
Ride, Sally, ride.
Let me love you, baby. Let me love you.
We had the producer up, but he's very good. He always says, you're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you. So, my dad was tone deaf. He made the curry for everybody to eat.
I heard you had a curry last night. What
you're seeing is quite a delicate. Well, I didn't make it. My dad's used to have currants and raisins and ball bearings in it, I'm sure. But my dad believed that the ball bearing was the saviour of humanity. But which, in essence, it was. I could go into detail there for you, but. Without the ball bearing, we wouldn't have won the Second World War, did you know?
Return to me.
it gets very close to the bone there. I think if you're an actor and you're tired, then you're, and it's been a very long week, and you, what we call it is you have to go to the place, you go to the dark place, and as an actor, you don't want to go there every night. Your job is to recreate those feelings for the audience so that the audience feel that. I didn't intend to today, but because I'm tired and okay, I lost my dad a few weeks ago as well, and because that song's all about loss, and it's just hard. And for me, this show's all about that connection. Although it's Susan's story, it's that connection to the audience, and it's everybody's story. There's a sort of political memory as well of those working men, those from those industrial, he was a miner, her dad and all that, from that background, who had all this talent, who had these beautiful singing voices, who wrote, who were involved in music or could play. Apparently her mum and dad always sat down and played the piano and all that as well. They were a very musical family, but that also wasn't unusual. So there's lots of, it's like muscle memory if you come from this part of the world, but also if you come from Yorkshire or other areas where working class families have grown up in a certain set of circumstances. Everybody's got the turn and chair.
You all look absolutely shattered.
We are last night.
No,
we're in.
I had a prayer meeting. Hallelujah,
says my
off. Doing anything new is always a bit of an adventure. And I think it obviously brings its own pressure. And there is a hard deadline of, you know, the 23rd of March, when there will be an audience sitting at the Newcastle Theatre Royal expecting to see a show.
Susan Boyle's coming to Newcastle's Theatre Royal next week with the world premiere of a musical all about her life. It's called I Dreamed a Dream. Elaine C Smith is taking on the title role, but Subo fans will be thrilled to hear that she might well make a guest appearance.
There is this terrible, unthinkable thing that you can't really confront, that you might not be ready and that it might not be right and that it might all be a terrible car crash.
We're at Newcastle Theatre Royal, it's day two of technical rehearsal. She's part of the family now, so we're off. She's a little bit nervous, and apparently she's not sung the second song for about 2 years.
The one she wears underneath was a bit too long, so we had to let the hem down on this one.
Fingers crossed I should say this, but it's going all very well at the moment.
Thank God. There's something
Prop.
I need to tell you.
Prop, it's not my fault. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Susan Boyle.
I look calm standing here for many years, but I'm not. This is what fear looks like. This was 4:30 this morning going,
oh, right.
And no matter how many shows you've done, it never feels any better. I just... terror.
Not at all scared.
We'll have to change underwear, you know. I don't want to wear yours. I'm not saying I'm going to wear yours.
The Britain's Got Talent gold dress. Do you know where it is?
It's in wardrobe, and it's just finished. But you can only do it, you can only enjoy this, you know, if you've got a good company. And we have 12 people who are wonderfully hysterical.
I've just pinned it.
You know, I pick things like this is the perfume I think Susan would wear. This is a real thing from you. Every character I've ever played's got a different perfume. Whether it be Widow Twanky, or a fairy, or whatever, or Shirley Valentine, they all had their own scent. Right, you have to get out now because I'm getting into my underwear. And nobody wants to see them. Shall I eat these chocolates instead?
Don't tell her.
Just... Well, that's very cruel of me.
What? Mistress!
I've got my Ramsey and Esmond on just for Elaine C Smith today. This afternoon we'll do a dress rehearsal, and then tonight we'll have the missing element. We'll have an audience, because that's going to have a big effect on the show as well.
I know, a priest in the family after all these years, your granny prayed. Your granny from Donegal always wanted a priest, but they get an actor dressed as a priest, it doesn't get... That's as close as they're going to get.
See? See?
See, that's your fault. I'm going to get into trouble now for holding up the tape.
The problem for me in the show is I'm on stage for 2 hours and I'm going from speaking to singing. Don't make me laugh. As you can hear, she takes her guitar relief. Mm. It's just tired. It's tired. So I'm trying not to speak, which is a bloody miracle for me.
That makes me a little bit worried.
And she's singing.
Oh, God.
I'm just there as an emergency, as a backup plan, if Elaine is ill or I don't know. Then if she's not performing, the understudy performs. It's hand on hip. It's side, 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 wiggle, wiggle, and a head nod.
So we're just about to do our dress rehearsal, the end of a long technical week, but we've got there.
Tom!
Yeah, it's come a long way from the initial day with 12 people and a piano in the corner. We're now at the stage of... we have an audience tonight. Big few days for the show and a big few days for us, but I relish this bit because once you have something, it's always easier to then spot where the flaws are, and certain things will get cut immediately because you'll find that they don't have any sort of resonance with an audience, and equally, nice. Things that you never saw coming would be... Oh, you know. Sorry, I didn't...
No, it's all right. Yeah. It's all fantastic.
Do you want to watch it down here? The best thing to
know. Yeah, sure.
Give me a brand new guitar 10 minutes before we go on stage.
Great, we've got a guitar.
See you in a minute, I'll do my best.
Yeah, have a good one.
Have a good one, mate. It's been great.
Remember the lines.
Yeah, try to.
You know what this is like, just the critical moment before it kicks in. So they're literally about to go, and I just want to see Susan very quickly before we start.
God, what she must be feeling to see your whole life in front of you.
And the two of us going out there and presumably using words that came out of our parents' mouths, out of our faces. I wonder which is... I'm not even going to think about that.
No, can't think about that.
Now, we've play to do. It must be very strange, though. Right, there we go.
Oh, here comes the production manager.
Oh, yes, yes, we have.
Guys, we'll just stand down, get back to the dressing room to take your coats off. It's going to be a while.
The light board's crashed, so we're just waiting for it to get rebooted.
Lights lighting board's crashed, everyone.
Oh.
Stand by.
Well, I suggest we have a whip round.
Yes.
Or rub two Boy Scouts together, they'd make electric.
I mean, you don't want to go on, but actually, you do want to go on.
Just stand down, stand down. Stand down.
Yes.
Bad dress rehearsal, good show.
No dress rehearsal.
Great show.
Possibly money in the meter?
Yes, I think it's 50 pence in the spot. I'm just going to get it.
Thank you.
I know this is hard, Susan, but you can't pretend it isn't happening. Your dad's very ill.
I know.
And he's only human, Susan.
Yeah, it's going to get better though, isn't it?
This is Susan, this is the Britain's Got Talent week. Very nice, isn't it? It's been a year and a half or more of my life, you know, and here we are in the theatre and she's here and she's singing and it'll be a great end to the show, you know. Because if we're rubbish, she'll come on and save the whole thing. Right, I'm on.
Thank you.
I'm on. I'll see you in a bit now.
You see yourself on stage. You see your father and mother's death being portrayed in a theatrical manner. And theatre is emotional, so the whole thing was just too much for him, you know. So it's difficult. It's difficult for anyone. But Elaine's, of course, Elaine got upset as well because Susan was upset.
Susan got very upset at watching the show today. So as you would, watching something as emotional as that about your own life. Mm-hmm. So, of course, I got quite upset because I wouldn't never do any hurt her, you know, I never want. But I was in a bit of a state, really, because I don't want her to be upset.
Oh,
I'm just giving out first night gifts for people, so it's a sort of
piggy Babcock, piggy Babcock, piggy Babcock.
Giles, I am a serial giver of stuff on opening night. I think it's a sort of a distraction, and. Yeah, to pretend it's not really happening. Not in here, doll. So they sat there in their brand knickers. Sorry. Here you go.
No.
I know. Right, I'm going to brush my teeth and get ready. That'll make you feel better.
Okay.
I am actually getting ready. Okay.
1,300 people in there going, right, entertain us. Tell us a Susan Boyle story. So, madness.
No! It's not really happening.
This wasn't Cinderella meeting a prince. This was Cinderella getting a career. And if you're going to shine that much light on something, then there's going to be a lot of darkness that will emerge as well on the other side.
This is your Act One beginner's call. Thank you.
You're so, so amazingly wonderful.
Evening, gentlemen.
Good
evening.
Mr.
British. Thank you very much.
Welcome down. Beautiful. Thank
okay.
you. Have a good show.
Okay. I'm
terrified as a performer at times before opening nights, but once I'm up and gone, I don't feel it. I want to do a good job.
Thank you, my darling.
It brings you back to you do it for that audience that's sitting there on that night. It has to be about that interchange with the audience.
Oh, my God.
There's always something very special about an audience seeing it for the very first time. Simultaneously, nothing as terrifying and as enjoyable for a director. One minute you're thinking, well, here we go, this is it now. Next moment you're thinking, oh God, it'll all be a disaster and nobody will laugh at anything, and, you know, it may not even get to the end of the first act.
It would be, but it was really, really good.
Very moving.
I didn't cry. No, I've been through all that all my life. I'm how old am I?
I'm looking forward to seeing her sing at the end. Allegedly, if she does sing.
She's got to come here tonight, it's the first night. You know, we're all expecting her.
Getting on stage for anybody can be scary. And the musical touches on that standing in a recording studio on your own with a set of headphones and a microphone, that's fine. Getting onto a platform in front of however many thousand people, that's something else.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Susan Boyle.
Seeing Susan Boyle is not the icing on the cake, it's the cherry on the icing on the cake.
Hello, Newcastle!
Just thrilled. Amazing.
Was it?
Yeah. Oh, God.
Was it?
Yeah,
really. Oh, good.
Brilliant.
Oh, God, don't.
You must be relieved.
Oh, I don't know what I feel.
It'll never be as hard as that again, will it?
Well, maybe tomorrow afternoon. Next couple of days. Here. A total cow. I've got wick here. I'll have this for weeks and weeks now. Oh, well, one down, 77 to go. The important thing for us is that it's a show on its own, whether Susan comes on or not. It's a show. Because, you know, Susan's going to have lots of other commitments and all of that and go off and do her albums and be world famous and all that. And that what we want to do is be able to tour the show and that it works. That's the thing for me. One way or another, I'm gonna find you. I'm gonna get you. One way or another, I'm gonna win you. I'm gonna get you. One way or another, I'm gonna see you. And if you enjoyed that, you'll find more video material on our website, stv.tv/Susan Boyle.